Hey, good morning, everyone. How are you?
Good morning, sir.
Okay, good morning. So I hope you all are doing good. And so let's wait for another 1 minute or so. So do any of you live in hostel, at least? Right now? Udbha, you want to say something?
No, sir, I'm not leaving right now. I'm thinking about moving next month.
Okay, cool. Okay, so let's get started. Any questions before we proceed? So let me answer some of the generic questions which some of you have asked, right? So we will float the first thing about the survey. So who need help in kind of NLP or machine learning, at least understanding some of the fundamentals, how to use, or probably what are the resources we can provide. So I will float the form today, later today. So you need to fill those who want. Second thing about some of you have asked about will you be provided, if the data set is quite big, computational resources or storage? Yeah, we will provide so. But for, again, so there is a condition for using so, right? I mean, definitely we will provide the computational resources and the storage. But we want you to first work on the problem statement, clearly define it. That is the first thing. Second thing, you also have to, before running your code just blindly on the server, because we cannot allow. Otherwise, I mean, we have very limited resource. It is not going to help anyone. So ideally, what I suggest to all students, so first, basically, just take a subset of the data set that you are going to work on, right? If you have a subset of data set, just try to produce some results. At least try to set up your code and everything on that small subset of data set. And if everything is in order, now the server is not for the development. Server is not for testing, right? Server is mainly everything is ready. Now you have to run your code on the server and just get the results, right? So that's how we prioritize who will be given access to server. And so regarding storage, I understand probably at least for the storage part, we can provide access to those who have big data set to download. But for running code on the server, only condition, you need to get your code done. You need to do a bit testing on a smaller data set first, on either on your local computer, laptop, or Google Colab or something, right? So, because as I said, I mean, server is mainly for running your final codes, get the final results. Any questions here? Anyone? I mean, are you agree with this? Otherwise, I mean, based on my experience, and because we have very limited resources, right? If we blindly give to everyone, it is going to create a chaos. So if you want the access to server early, just start the project early. Just show us some progress and just convince us, okay, so now you are done with your part and now you need server access to do the rest of the thing. We'll be very happily provide the access to server immediately to you based on your current status. Any questions before we proceed? Anyone? It's sunny day today, right? Are still people sleeping?
No, sir, no question.
Okay, good. Okay, great. So I believe there is no further questions. Most of you have already created your group, so let me. projects. So regarding the groups who have still looking for partners, so I guess there are two groups. So one possibility, Talib and Arshdeep, are you here?
Yes, sir, I am here.
Okay, great. So please speak to other person. Who is here? Is it Talib or Arshdeep?
Sir, I am Talib.
Talib, okay, good. Yes. So Talib, so please contact Arshdeep. Did you already contact him?
Yes, sir, I have already contacted him.
So what did he say? Is he part of any group or is he willing to make group with you or what is the current situation?
Sir, I don't know about him. So.
No, you don't know him or did you get, so you did not get reply from him, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So one possibility could be a new person is probably going to join the course, Rajat Agrawal. You may, is Rajat, are you here?
Yes, sir, I am here.
So are you still looking for, the group mates?
Sir, I could finalize it yesterday.
Oh, you already finalized. Okay, that's fine. In that case, yes, in that case, yeah, Talib, just look at the different groups we have. So I request the group of having 2, 3, or 4. So Talib, your name is here, right?
No, sir, it's temporary here.
Okay. So Arshdeep is not here. Anyways, so Talib, I request you to just contact all the groups. Having 3, 4, 2 members. So I request, for whom, if it is possible for you to accommodate a person, a new member in the group, again, I cannot force anyone, but if you can accommodate, please include him in your team. Okay.
Okay.
So Talib, yeah. So from your side, you can contact the different groups and other groups, if possible, please include him.
Okay, sir.
And hopefully, Talib, you can also get reply from Arshdeep in case he is able to make a group with you. Yeah. So regarding groups, I believe we have most of the groups ready now. So as the next part, as I mentioned, for the different groups, we are going to assign a mentor, or you can say to TA, who is going to help you in a weekly basis. At least we will set up a weekly office hour where you can discuss any details, any issue that you are facing. And you can also contact them through the emails if you have any other queries. And let me know, if I can also help you in some way. Okay. And regarding topics, I guess I can see a number of people have already selected their project. So that's good. So I would also recommend you. So once we assign a TA to your group, you can also discuss the project, your project with your TA, so that basically you can think of how you can basically define the problem statement very clearly. The project proposal that you have to submit, firstly, you have to fully understand the problem statement, what you're going to solve. And so that you can discuss with your TA as well. And I strongly recommend to do so. So in the last class, when we were leaving, I guess Indranil or someone has asked, can we take another project and somehow discuss how it can be solved using engineering-based project and how if we have to solve through research-based project. So for example, we have to solve this problem detecting fake and real tweets, right? When we're talking about data, whether it's a fake or real tweets. So in case of research project, right? In case of a research project, you need to probably create a data set, or probably you can use any existing Twitter data set. So I believe when we say the real or fake tweet, so I believe here again, you have to define the problem statement very clearly. What do you mean by fake? What do you mean by real? So I believe a real tweet is something which has been posted on tweet. That's it, right? Fake tweet is something which has not been posted, but somehow portrayed this someone has posted. Again, fake news can come in form of images. It can form of in form of text, right? So the problem statement is, given a tweet, again, you have to narrow down your problem statement, right? Whether it's a text tweet, whether it's a image tweet, or probably both or something else, right? So you need to clearly define what is the input to your system, and the output will be kind of binary operation, kind of binary classifier, whether it's a fake or not, or whether it's a real or not, right? So in case of research-based projects, so you already have, okay, so you may simply select some kind of data set, some Twitter data set, or create your own. And since you have created or kind of used publicly available Twitter data set, it means they are real tweets, right? So in that case, you also need to have some fake tweets. How you can do so? Either you generate it, if this problem statement is already available, if some data set is already there, like these are the real tweets, these are the fake tweets. In that case, I mean, you simply have to take the data set and probably build your model and do some kind of evaluation, how good your proposed model is, how good it is performing for fake news, fake tweets, how bad it is performing for, I mean, fake tweets, right? So this is something, I mean, I'm expecting as part of the research based, right? In case of engineering based project, I mean, here, as I said, I mean, the output we are expecting is something tangible. That is something, a prototype that I can try by myself. And how you can deploy that? So probably you can have, say, a bot or something. Or probably it could be some kind of web interface where I can feed an input again. So it depends on what kind of system that you're going to solve. So you give an input. Again, it can be URL, it could be something else. I mean, again, I leave it up to you how you figure out. So once it is able to have different tweets, simply, I mean, you have to build a system which can basically perform this activity, whether it's a real tweet, whether it's a fake tweet, based on the different operation you perform in the backend, right? And finally, how informative is that? That can be evaluated based on the user survey, that can be evaluated based on other things. So because if you're going to just simply doing exact matching, right? Exact matching is something, in that case, I mean, the project will be not more than an assignment, right? If I'm just talking about text. So in that case, it will be too simplistic. It will be too simplistic if you're just going to text, just going to match the text, right? So you'll have to think beyond that. So this problem will be more interesting and probably will be qualified for a project, for a semester long project, if probably it involves a little bit more complexity. So that complexity could be in terms of, say, image as well. So often when you encounter fake news or fake tweet, you see some kind of screenshot, right? If you see some kind of screenshot and the text is kind of modified or probably faked. So ideally, for the engineering based project, in this case, we are expecting, okay, so you could have some kind of image, and probably you may need to perform OCR as well in order to fetch the text which is mentioned there. And after that, basically you can think of comparing with all the database, or probably again, so you'll have to see how you can compare with the different tweets that you have in your database and say whether it's a real or fake. Is it clear to you? I mean, does it clarify your doubts regarding what should be covered in research-based project? What should be covered in engineering-based project?
Hello, sir.
Questions here? Yeah, Biman.
Yes, I have one question, like coming to engineering projects. So what exactly, like, do you want us to host our application in local host or something like in cloud based, like in AWS or Azure or something?
Yeah, so I answered this question before as well. Yeah, simply you can install, say, host on Herigo or some kind of publicly available thing, right?
Okay.
Any other questions? Okay, so I consider this silence as there is no further questions. So again, I strongly encourage you to discuss the project that you're planning to work with your TAs, and that list will be shared today, later today. I mean, who will be the TA for your group? So with this, let me start the class today. Okay, so thanks everyone again, and welcome to the class of information retrieval. So in the previous lectures, we have discussed details about an overview of information retrieval. We discussed different problems which qualify for the information retrieval. We discussed different example, how the information retrieval can be performed. We discussed a generic pipeline, which is basically true for any kind of information retrieval, be it like text-based information retrieval, be it image-based and so on, right? So with that note, so let's go back to the more fundamentals of information retrieval, specifically the text-based information retrieval system. With this note, we have also discussed in the last class, I mean the before class, in the earlier days, most of the data that you encounter, I mean, is kind of unstructured data that people create, right? But when they have to perform the retrieval, so often they have some kind of structured data because they did not have much ability to process the unstructured data in order to understand the query or in order to basically perform the information retrieval. So over the time, because the user's need is often in terms of unstructured query. That's why, I mean, the people develop capabilities over the time and still working on that, how you can understand the given text query or information need so that you can provide appropriate answer. So before I go further, I would like, someone can respond, what do you understand by information need? What do you understand by query? And what do you understand by the results of an information retrieval system? Anyone would like to comment? What is information need?
Sir, if we can compare it in the context of a query, sir, I think information need is something we are actually wanting to search. And sir, query is what the text we enter for searching something. So sir, they both can actually be very different from each other. And sir, search result is based on query, not on information need. So whatever you'll be giving as an input, the search results will come accordingly.
Very nice. Very nice, Akshant. Anyone else want to add something?
Hello.
Yeah, Kapil.
Yes, sir. So basically, just as you have told in the previous lecture, that there is some fixed representation. So I think information needed to the system is some representation which it can use efficiently, and the query is can be any representation. It not need to be the fixed representation which the system needs, and the result is like the correct representation again against the query that the user has inputted.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, kind of, yeah, touching what I'm looking for. Last, anyone want to go, add more?
Something we don't know is information for us.
Very nice. So something you don't know, it means, probably you need more information about the topic. So information is need is something. Yeah, so you need more information or knowledge about some topic. And how you represent, again, so this is your information need, right? This is the topic you need, you want more information about. Then how about query? So what is the query in that case?
A question asked to understand what we don't know.
Sir, query is a straightforward answer, like we are searching for and we can directly get the answer. But of the crux of whatever we are looking for, and deriving each and every aspect of it. It's the information.
Yeah. So kind of very close answer. So as I said, information need is more about, I mean, probably some topic you need more knowledge or information about, right? In query is something, the way you convey your, convey your intent, or you can say the convey your, basically the questions to the system, right? So for example, in this case, again, so there is a kind of semantic gap. There is always a semantic gap between the information you need and probably the questions you ask, because often in simple words, you cannot convey the information that you want, right? In that case, you need to probably come up with queries or the questions that you want to ask should be as close as to the information that you're looking for. If there is a gap, I mean, you are going to get a kind of wrong answer for that. So that's why it's very simple, is garbage in, garbage out, right? So garbage in, if the, your query representation, if the query representation of query, or probably the way you represent the query or portray your query to the system is not conveying the information you need, you are going to get the wrong response, wrong results from the database. So that, with that note, let's get started. So to start with, the very simple concept in information retrieval, if you have some, if you want to get some knowledge about any topic, right? So in that case, as I said, I mean, you need to ask something, and the way you ask the way you ask more details about the system by some query. So in this case, I mean, what your queries will be, what your document will be. So in case of text information retrieval system, often the query is a kind of set of words, or you can set of lexicons, right? So often you can also think it is made of different terms. So when we say the term, so often the query is made of different terms. And again, it is limited in size. You can say often it's a 2, 3, 4, or 5 words or terms. A document, again, here we are referring, a document is a set of words or tokens, fairly a large one as compared to the query. So like in case of term query, so often that it carries probably 3 to 5 terms or queries or words. But in case of documents, often it is fairly large, say 1,000 words or 1,000 tokens, right? So when we have to find, when if we talk about ad hoc information retrieval, right, you have a query and you have a set of documents. Again, both are bag of words of kind of data. So in case of query, it is a bag of say 3 to 5 words. In case of document, it is a bag of say 1,000 words, right? So if I ask you how ad hoc information retrieval will work here, what is the kind of brute force method you will apply? Anyone?
Search, simply check word by word.
We simply check word by word. Very nice answer, right? So in this way, we can simply check what the words we have in the query, what words we have in, say, the documents. In this way, definitely, we can do. In fact, in the past, it was happening like that, right? But what is the drawback you can see in this case?
So computationally expensive.
It will be computationally very, very expensive, right? What else?
So it will take so much of time.
Exactly. So I mean, because you have to match each word one by one, right? As you mentioned. So again, it is computationally expensive, and if there is a lot of computation, definitely it will take more time to process the information. So usually when you do any information retrieval on Google, how long it will take? How long usually it takes to process a query? Do you recall? I mean, do you get such any numbers?
So generally about a second.
Yeah, it's a kind of fraction of a second, even not a second. I mean, if you see, I mean, often you search something in the earlier user, Google used to say like in 0.002 some second, something, you fetch the results for you, right? So it's even not a second, it's just a fraction of a second. And why Google want to process this information very fast to you or anyone?
So that we can get our result pretty quick.
Right. And why do we want to give the result very quickly to the user?
So many people can search.
Yes, many people can search so that there is no lag or bottleneck.
Okay. Any other
user experience,
right? Yeah. So of course, because the people are the human are kind of very impatient people, right? I mean, they don't want to wait. Even if you go to any Indian office or something, bank, right? You try to find Jugaad. I mean, how you can break the queue and probably get the work done immediately, right? So it's kind of human are very impatient. I mean, they want to get any information immediately and very accurate as well. So as we have discussed in the previous classes, if not, so there is always a trade-off. There is always a trade-off between how accurate information you want to get and how fast you want to get, right? So for example, if we have to find a very accurate answer, right? I mean, what you're looking for. In that case, I hope you can realize if you want to give very accurate answer, 100% correct answer, you are going to process all matching. You have to, for example, we are talking about, you have a set of documents, you have set of, queries which has a number of tokens. In order to give the very precise answer, you need to do perform matching for all. And suppose you have millions or billions of document, right? How hard and how long it is going to take, right? It won't be work in real time. So often any interactive system. So that is why, these days people focus on how we can involve human in between and how we can basically model the human behavior, right? So for example, what happens in the past days, if you have any query, you ask the expert and expert reply to you. And basically he is kind of encyclopedia. The guru is something, or probably some saint is something, is an encyclopedia. You ask anything, you will get the answer immediately, right? The same way, user don't want to wait. I mean, they want immediate answer for anything. And also the precise answer, very accurate answer. In that case, I hope you can realize. So it depends on, right? I mean, even if saint has to, or someone has to answer the question, he will have to think about it. If one option, he just start just garbage out anything, right? But that may not be relevant. So that's why you want relevant as well as quick information as early as possible. So in that case, you need better way of probably matching. So in that case, brute force matching of simply tokens and the document is not going to work. So I hope you agree with this, right? If you agree with this, then what are the other solution? What else we can do? So probably we can discuss in more in the coming slides. So let me go first talking about how the term document indices matrix can be built. So earlier in unstructured data, say in 1620, right? So there are Shakespeare's, he used to write a number of plays, right? So if you have to perform information retrieval by that time, so do you think people were doing information retrieval in 1620 something? I mean, how they were doing information retrieval in 1600 when there is no computer or there is no such system?
Sir, it must have been done manually by some form of clerk or someone like that.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, librarians and people like who bookkeep records, they are a classic example of like information retrieval. So basically the person in charge asks them to maintain this, and so they would be like well versed and trained in that, and they would be able to retrieve quickly than normal other readers.
Very nice. And how do you think the librarian system work?
So there are like multiple indexing systems. So they index by domains, and further in domains they have further classifications.
Very nice. So it means we need to do some kind of, the people earlier used to do, they do some kind of indexing again. So that indexing again, so there could be different kind of indexing. So like in this case, suppose we have a query. So which plays of Shakespeare contain the word Brutus and Caesar, but not Calpurnia, right? So how do you think, we are going to deal with this query, at least in the earlier stages?
So first we will list out the plays of Shakespeare. So right. And then we can remove those which contain, first we will search those which contain Brutus, Caesar, and Calpurnia, and then we can remove those which have Calpurnia in them, like that.
Very nice. Very nice. So it's more kind of, you can perform complement operation for the Calpurnia, right? And for the Brutus and Caesar, you only have a list of plays, and then you can perform. So that is one way. So if we talk about recent operations, so for example, it's more kind of, even in the Linux, you have an operation called grep, right? Have you used grep?
Yes, sir.
Okay, nice. So yeah, so using grep, one possibility could be you simply grep all the Shakespeare's play for Brutus, Caesar, and then strip out lines for containing Calpurnia, and this way you can get it. So one, and why do you think, that is not the answer? If we have to do this, what is the issue? So firstly, it will be slow. Given it may be a very large Calpurnia. Not Calpurnia is maybe trivial. Is it that not trivial, right? Other operation, like if you have to find Romans near countrymen, it's more when we have to search by the proximity, right? Which is not possible in this case. And also the ranked retrieval, in this case, you will get the precise result, right? Whether it's a matching or not. Here, we are not talking about ranking them. So we will discuss with all those in the coming slides and probably the later lectures as well. So I hope you can see, that's why earlier it was not that trivial to perform such kind of operation. So that's how, the people come up with the term document indices matrices. So as rightly mentioned by Divisa, so for Brutus, what we can do, for Brutus, we can have a matrix where you have Brutus as a term, and these are the document term indices. So here the term is the different, you can say the term or words or the tokens you can think of can be used for the query. And the document is all the plays of Caesar, say, Shakespeare at the moment. So in this case, like Brutus was in Antony and the Cleopatra. In the Julius Caesar, in Hamlet. Yeah, that's it, all three. Similarly for Caesar, you can have such a term and document indices matrix and so on. So one place, if it contains the word, zero otherwise. So if we have to perform this query, how we'll do? Simply, we need to look for the Brutus. So Brutus basically appeared in these three plays. Caesars appear in these five plays. This particular play, this particular play, and then Hamlet, Othello, and Macbeth, right? Then in case of not Calpurnia, so Calpurnia is present only in Julius Caesar. So not complement is simply a very simple binary operation. You'll get all the remaining plays. So I hope it is clear. In this case, you can solve this question, right? You can solve this query and get the corresponding answer by just doing an intersection or logical AND or something. You can get it, right? You can get it by ending. So you'll see, so this is one, and its complement is one. So it means this might be an answer. Similarly, Calpurnia is one, so it will be remain zero, right? So it will be somehow we'll skip Julius Caesar, and we'll see, what are the other documents you can give as a response to the given query. What are the issues that you can see here? Of course, you can solve the query, given query, based on this term in this incident matrix. Can you see any issue here? If we have to solve this particular query using this 0 and 1 incident matrix.
The matrix may be sparse.
metrics will be very, very sparse, right? So we have basically, if you see, I mean, right now we have zero and ones. So in this case, I mean, we have only mentioned few terms. In fact, if you look at, I mean, it will be very, very large vocabulary you'll have. Similarly, in terms of play, I mean, you'll have many, many such plays from Shakespeare's. So overall, if you look at, I mean, this overall metrics will be very, very sparse, right? So I hope, so this query was clear to you in the last slide. So the answer to the query, take the vectors of Brutus, take the vector of Caesar, and not California, just complement it and perform the bitwise AND. In this way, the Brutus was represented by 110100, 110100, and so on. And simply once you perform the bitwise AND, you'll get the answer 100100. So one is kind of this particular play, and next one is Hamlet. So in this way, I mean, you can find answer to your query. So these two are the play and probably the scene. This is how probably you have indexed, and you'll get the answer to your given query. So one issue that you have rightly mentioned, it will be sparse. Let's discuss this with an example. Suppose you have 1 million document, because if you're working with say Google or probably many such big information retrieval based system, I mean, they have not only million, but probably billions as well, documents. And assume, I mean, on average, each document has 1,000 words, right? And on average, 6 bytes per words, including space punctuation. So on average, you can say 6 GB of data in the documents. So again, if it is for a million, on an average, say 1,000 words, if it is going to be bigger, in fact, it is bigger. So you can understand, I mean, how big data you're dealing with and how difficult it will be for computer if you're going to follow the term incidence metric that we have just discussed, right? So for example, in this case, if you have your dictionary, so when I say the dictionary or vocabulary, I mean all the unique words that you are going to have in your system, unique words, or you can say the tokens. So like in this case, if you have a say 1 million documents, you may assume it might be probably 500K distinct terms or will be there. So as we have discussed, if you are going to build term incidence metric in this case, it will be 500K into 1 million metrics, has a half trillion zeros and half million ones. So someone has mentioned, since it is very sparse, so what could be solution?
Linked list kind of
store only ones, right? So that could be one possible option, because end of the day, you don't much concern about what zeros are, right? I mean, because if you have to provide information need, often you mainly have to focus on, okay, so where it is present, right? So in this case, if you're going to store all those information, all zeros and ones, it is going to be too much. But if you consider only ones, I mean, this is trillions, but if you're going to store only ones, it will be probably billions only. How these billions will be? Since you have 1 million documents and probably each document has say 1,000 words. So 1 billion is, you can say, more in the highest side. It will be less because there will be some common words, common tokens in different documents. So, but on average, you can say, I mean, yeah, so it is 1 billion ones. So metrics is again extremely sparse, right? And in this way, if you only have to deal with ones, at least you are able to remove the zeros that you have in the metrics. So now what is the representation to represent this 1 billion ones? So one representation that we have saw is the metrics. But if you are going to represent the metrics, again, it is going to be very sparse. What are the other representation you can think of? Someone has just said linked list, right? So one solution to that, if we only have to record the ones, if you have to only record the ones, one solution could be, I mean, yeah, so you can create linked list. But how this linked list will be represented? Because end of the day, you have to perform indexing, right? So what you'll do, I mean, as you rightly mentioned, so one option could be linked list. But do you think linked list is the only solution, or could you use any other data structure as well? Yes,
ma'am. That can represent a sparse matrix well will do.
Mm-hmm.
So dynamic arrays.
Dynamic arrays. Very nice. Anything else?
Hashmap.
Trees.
Yeah, Divya.
Trees,
okay. Yeah, so I mean you can think of different data structure. Again, so different data structure will come up. Yeah, Shubham.
Sir, you're saying we can use a linked list.
Okay.
We can use a linked list and each word will contain, each word will link to all the document that it contain, that word is associated with. Like mm-hmm. if we have Julius, Julius will point to document one, document two, document, all the documents in which Julius is there.
Yeah, very nice. Very nice. So, I mean, this is particular term is at least in information retrieval is called inverted index or inverted file. So here what you do, so different terms that you have. So as you rightly mentioned, so some kind of representation that we want to have. So for the different terms we have, we only want to link the different document which has this particular term. So again, you can do in different ways. One possibility could be simply use array, right? If you have use an array, so use in that array, you can make the entries for different documents. So you can see the document number. So in this way, basically you can keep track of different document which having this particular index. So when you have to perform the information retrieval, simply look at into these documents rather than looking into whole 1 million document. And that is the benefit of indexing, because in this way you can make your search or retrieval faster, right? So because now you don't have to look into all 1 million document that you have. So for example, as we have given example, you have 1 million document as a for a term, vocabulary has say 500 tokens, 500,000 tokens. In that case, suppose I come up with a token which is only came in say 5 document, right? So for a given query which asking for this particular token, I mean, now I'm only going to look into the 5 document which has it rather than looking into whole 1 million. So in this way, I mean, indexing usually help you a lot, especially the inverted index here, because for a given, so because one indexing could be, I mean, given document, you index all the words it has, right? Another indexing could be, which is called the inverted index or the inverted file. So you index different documents based on the different token you have. So this is exactly we do in inverted index. So you identify each document by a document ID or document serial number. And as we have discussed, one very simple possibility could be simply use an array. So if you use an array, like for Brutus say, for example, have come up in these documents. Caesar have came into these documents. Caliponia in these documents. So in this way, you can use fixed size array to resolve, to basically perform the inverted index. So what will be the major issue with if we use fixed array? Anyone?
So there can be scenario where Brutus has come in 20 documents, but Caesar has not come, has come in one document. So because of the fixed array, our space will get wasted. So instead of that, we can use linked list.
Very nice. Yeah, so because if you are going to use fixed size array, for every list you are going to have, the same number of elements in the, or you can see the array size. So one, you have rightly mentioned for some array, for Brutus, I think it's very fully, but for Caliponia, probably it may have only one. So despite it has only one document, you are using the space for whole fixed array, right? So that is one issue. What could be other issue? Any other issue that you can think of?
We may find a new document which contains certain words, then when we want to insert that, like we won't have any space maybe.
Very nice, very, very nice. So for example, so when we have created this index, because we assume, so Shakespeare has made these many documents. So what if Shakespeare just write a new one? What if, we have just found out a new, you can say play of Shakespeare, which was say someone has stolen or probably someone has just create a new document on Shakespeare, right? Having Brutus. So if you're going to add a new document, if you don't have space in the array, what we'll have to do? You'll have to create a new arrays again, right? So that's altogether is a new challenge, right? So for example, in this case, what happens in the word Caesar is added to the document 14, right? If it is added to document 14, now there is no space left for Caesar. You cannot add 14 in this fixed size array. So it means you need a kind of better representation in order to basically handle such dynamic need, because information is keep getting created. Information is keep getting updated. At least when you deal with real-time information retrieval on the web. So yeah, Kriti, you have any question?
Sir, here still we have like for a particular word, we are storing documents like for Brutus and Caesar. We are having these two words in the same document. So again, the redundancy is there. So how we are saving on space?
So here basically because if you combine both together, right? If you combine both together, how if someone is just asking Brutus, you are also giving Caesar, right? And many times, suppose I have to perform a query. I have to perform a query, Brutus but not Caesar. If you combine both them, but you already have only one, inverted file for that. How you are going to deal with? Because if you have to perform, for example, because here we are processing all the queries here by performing some binary operation, right? And when you perform the binary operation, any complex binary operation, how eventually you break this into the smallest possible element, right? Right?
Okay, sir. Yes.
So if you have to perform the query in the smallest possible element, you'll have to keep it minimal. You'll have to keep it the smallest possible. You have to index at the smallest possible way. Otherwise, you may not be able to perform different possible queries. And the purpose of information retrieval system, you'll have to answer any kind of query, right? And if you have to perform that, you'll have to index at, you can say, the smallest level.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Any other questions? Okay, so if not, at least you can realize here, if you are going to use fixed size array for the inverted index, it is not going to work for especially the two reasons, right? So by the way, the terms that you're using, they are called tokens, terms of word. And this particular document that you have for a given term is called the posting. And yeah, so whole this set of documents or tokens that you have, whole set of tokens and the words that you have is called dictionary or the vocabulary. And postings is basically all the list of documents that you have for a given query. These are the generic terms when you're going to perform the inverted index. So that's why we need kind of variable size postings list, right? Because just we saw the example in the previous slide. What is the issues if we have the fixed size array or fixed size posting list? So that's why we need variable size posting list and how you can perform the variable size posting list. Some of you have already mentioned in the previous discussion, we can use kind of linked list. I guess Venkatesh also mentioned variable length arrays. So it means there are several ways you can do so. So in this way, you can perform the trade-off size iteration, because if it is a list, you can, and any documents, for example, document 14 added Caesar words, in that case, we simply add that into this particular list. right? In this way, you can perform different queries, different thing. One commonality you can see here. So this is one postings, this is one postings, this is one postings. Or you can say, this is the postings for Brutus, Caesar, Calpurnia. What common thing you see here?
So they all are sorted?
Ordered.
They are all sorted, very nice. And anybody want to comment why they are sorted? Why do we need to keep them sorted?
So, basically, if we want to look up for specific documents, that would be easy. We can do a binary search. And also, like, if we want to perform operations like basically Brutus and Caesar, we would be taking intersection.
Why do we need to perform binary search? Because every document here having the word Caesar.
Yes, sir. Like, if we are looking for like a specific document, like reverse lookup.
Okay.
And also, like, if we are performing intersection like Brutus and Caesar, the conjunctive query, then actually sorting it would help. Like, we can stop where they are not matching.
Okay. Very nice. Very nice.
Sir, there can be any query like time based if we want to search documents which were posted earlier. So that can be useful.
Very nice. So basically, so here the sorting, we can do sorting in any ways, right? So that sorting could be, as you rightly mentioned, that sorting could be by time base. So probably the recent document first and latest document later, right? It could be document ID. It could be other thing, right?
A practical use case might be that that Calpurnia, if you want to search for Calpurnia and Brutus, so if we have to search for that, Calpurnia is found in the few documents, if we know, by parallel threading, like Brutus is searching in one thread. So it will know that till 101 we have to look for. So after 101, it will leave rest of them. So it will
very nice.
Performance boost.
Very nice. Very nice. So I hope it is clear to everyone. So basically, in a way, what are you doing, Lucas? In a way, what you have just did?
It's a
performance. You are improving the performance, right? Yes. So because if you're going to the brute force way, ideally you need to look at all the basically the posting list, right?
Yes.
But there is no point of going if your query is Brutus and Calpurnia, right? I mean, you know, there is no document after 101 having Calpurnia. Then there is no point of going for rest of the 1 million documents.
Exactly, sir.
Right. Very nice. So search by document ID, sorted by document ID, as we have already discussed this. I probably will discuss more in details later on. So let's talk about how you can now, because I hope you understand now how the inverted index work, how you perform the indexing. So let's create one in inverted index. So how you can create the inverted index? So suppose you have different documents to be indexed and you are having different tokens like friends, Romans, countrymen, etc. and etc. So the first thing you do in any, in fact, if you are going to deal with any, I mean, natural language processing based system, often the first step you would do, the first pre-processing you do, is do the tokenization. So what I mean by tokenization is you simply you can say the break the different documents into smaller tokens. So that tokens are essentially kind of words. So like in this case, the this particular list of documents that you have into tokenized into the small token streams like friends, Romans, countrymen. So that is the first thing. I hope, I mean, those who have taken NLP and probably even ML may have certainly discussed what the tokenization is. But anyways, I mean, anybody has any question what this tokenization is, what it is doing? So it's simply breaking the whole. So for example, a document having 1000 word. So we are dividing one document having 1000 word into 1000 small tokens, small words. Okay. Any questions? What is tokenization? Nice. So the next step is linguistic modules. So what you do, you modify the tokens. So for example, we converted friends to friend. So anybody want to comment what all modification we have done here?
Singular to plural to singular we have converted.
We have converted from plural to singular. And why we have done so?
Sir, because root, we want root to word just preserve the semantic meaning of...
Sir, root word. We are extracting the root word.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So that nice. We can get more of it. Like there can be different forms of word in the document. So it can match with that different forms.
Very nice. So the reason, I hope you can understand. So here, just to for the reference for everyone. So here, I mean, either we are talking about friends or friend. Semantically, they are we are talking about the same thing, right? So ideally, the queries will be semantically well represented for this. So the reason being, if you are going to compare, so for example, a document having friends and your query is friend, right? If you are going for exact matching, they are not going to match, right? So in that way, I mean, despite they are giving semantically similar, or probably if this might be a relevant document, you're skipping this. So that's why people, what often do, people convert the different words to their root form. So for example, if it is friendly, then also we convert to friend. If it is friends, then also we convert to friend. If it is friend, then it is already a friend, right? And again, I mean, you can think of many other such different variation of different word, and you need to convert them into friend. So in this case, what is the second changes you can see? So friends is converted to friend. What are the other change you can see?
All made to small letters.
All need to be, so basically you have performed the lowercase of all the words, right? And why you have done so again?
So like if there is a lowercase word and if we do exact matching, it won't match. So we can, for matching purpose, we made it to all.
Exactly. So again, whether it's a friend with F capital or whether it's a friend all in lowercase, both represent semantically same meaning, right? So, but when you are going to do the matching, will they give you, they are same or different? They are different because they are different ASCII and probably something. So both are different stream. So in case of natural language processing, we often, another pre-processing that we do, we perform the lowercasing of all the document that you have. Can you also perform the uppercase instead of lowercase?
Yes, sir.
Very nice.
We can perform.
Very nice. Because here the idea is to make systematic. So it may, you can say, make it more uniform, right? So either keep everything in uppercase, either keep everything lowercase. But often people just go for lowercase because probably it's better in reading. Or probably, yeah, that's it. Not much.
Right? Sir, I have one doubt.
Yeah.
Can there be a difference in the root word and the inflected word? Like for better, the root word is good. So are this also we including in this linguistic module, or it's only about like from friends to friends? So root word and inflected word are same, but if I consider like better and good.
So yeah, I'm coming to that.
Okay.
So for example, just look at the last one, countrymen. So if you see, I mean, definitely what one thing you have done, you have performed the countrymen, lowering case, but can you also see the difference? Men is converted to man, right? So that is one thing. So often what happens, so there is different ways you can perform the linguistic modules, right? So there are two popular techniques. One is called stemming, another is called lemmatization, right? So I guess, Divisa, did you ask or someone else?
Oh, yes, sir, I asked.
Oh, Divya asked. Okay. So the one you are asking is about lemmatization, right? So often happens, so there are two ways you can basically find the root words. And inflection, as you also referring to the inflection. So the one problem with the stemming, I think I have the slide. Okay. So not here. So what happens in case of? So for example, you have the example. Some of the example that given, right? So whether it's a good or probably some other form you can think of, right? So what happens if you're only going to convert, perform the stemming? So again, there are several ways you can, there are several algorithms you can perform the stemming. So Porter stemming is one of the most popular ways you can perform this stemming. So how do you find the root word for a given word? In that case, I mean, the friend will be converted to, friends will be converted to friends. Similarly, the friendly will be converted to friend. But there are different many words which, if you perform the stemming, the output word that you'll be having may not be a valid word, right? So that may not be a valid. So in that case, and often, I mean, it doesn't support the cases where basically you have two synonyms, right? Or probably similar words, but they are, if you compare them, they're different, but ideally they are having the same meaning. So that's why the people, the address, the limitation of the stemming, people come up with lemmatization. So in case of lemmatization, they deal with such kind of issue, and they basically not only perform the root word, getting the root word, which having the correct meaning, correct valid word, but also the deals with the reflective words of that. So like good, better, and something. So ideally, either it's a good or better, right? So they are basically performing the similar thing. So did I answer your question to Divya?
Yes, sir.
So once you perform,
So like just as you said right now, like the stemming is done by taking the root word having commonality between them. So like how is it done? Like all the words, are they matched with them? Means like the intersection part is taken out and then checked. Then it will be a huge time taking process, right?
So for stemming, right?
Yes.
So for stemming, again, I mean, the pre-processing takes time. I mean, because you are making the retrieval system fast because you already perform a lot of pre-processing, you already perform indexing and everything. But again, it's a one-time task, right? So that's why people is fine spending this much time doing all the pre-processing, doing all whatever the pre-processing they have to perform, and whatever the all the indexing. Because if you're, have you done any indexing? I mean, indexing takes time because it has to scan all the documents, try to find all the tokens, perform the tokenization. Again, whether you are going to use stemming or you are going to use lemmatization, you have to perform all those stuff, right? But it's a one-time task because once it is indexed, I mean, you have simply have to match. And in this way, I mean, all the big companies, like, they are able to provide the result in a very, very fast manner. Yes. Anyone asking something, Priya? Okay. So in this way, as you can see here, so finally you have, after tokenization, you modify the terms. And after that, basically, once you find the tokens, you can index on these tokens. So for example, friend has come in document 2, 4, and probably others. Similarly, Roman has come in 1, 2. And countrymen come only in 13 and 16. In this way, once you have this inverted index, you can perform the retrieval with the example that we have discussed earlier. So these are initial stages of text processing. So yeah, so this is the example of text processing. Priya, could you mute yourself? Okay, so just like in this case, so deal with John's. So John will be kind of what you can perform. So cut the character sequence in the word token. So in this way, I mean, you only consider John here. So normalization, often there are several ways you can write the same thing, whether it's like USA or U.S.A or kind of United States of America. I mean, there are several ways often you do so. So can you map and text, all these. So in that we, so these, all these are basically called the normalization. So map the text and query terms to the same form. Stemming, so this is what I'm referring to earlier. So you may wish to perform different routes to match, but as mentioned, so there are several issues with the stemming. So that's why people often use lemmatization rather than stemming. Stop words, so often you may omit very common words. So just like the AO, so these are basically the, you can say the articles, pronouns, and so on, right? So can we basically, because while doing the natural processing, often the documents that you process, you see the frequency of such documents are very, very high. So for example, how many times you say is, am, are, how many times you say they, and so on, right? So they are very, very frequent. So if they're very frequent, and if you rely on, if you rely on only on, you can say these stop words, I mean, that may basically often give you false positive result. So for example, my query is Brutus has killed Caesar, right? In that case, if we are going to consider the term or token has as well, probably you may come up with many other such document. In fact, all the 1 million document may has may have basically have has. In that case, I mean, you need to perform, basically your processing time will be increased because only probably the three posting list have the Brutus and say Caesar and killed, but unnecessary you are processing all the documents having has, that basically has nothing to do with Brutus and Caesar, right? So that is the reason we have to basically omit these words when we are performing, at least when we were doing in the early days, natural language processing. So in this way, suppose you have two documents in there. So you have document one, document two. So if you recall, what was the first step? First step was perform tokenization. So if you perform tokenization here, what are the tokens you'll get here from here? So you'll get I, date, enact, Julius Caesar, I was killed, Junius Caesar, I was killed, and so on. Similarly, if you perform the tokenization of the second one, you'll get all this stuff. So in this way, you have term, you have the documents, and so. Can anybody guess what will be the next step? What we are going to do here?
Removing the stop words.
Removing the stop words. Yeah, that's right. Basically, that you can do, because if you're going to index based on that, I mean, you may end up with very, very, not very useful documents. So basically, I mean, one thing I mean we perform in the indexing is the sorting. If you recall, if we are going to sort this, so often if we have to say, suppose look for the word S, you simply come to the index here and probably skip the rest of the things. So in this way, basically this will also help you in creating the sorted document of for different index. So this is one of the core indexing step. So you need to sort by items. So if you look at, we simply sort this. And after sorting, it will be like I will go down and probably this word starting from A will go up. So in this way, you can see now the list of documents are mix of one and two based on the this. One, what are the issue that you can see here?
So redundancy,
right? So because the same word may come up into more than one document. So how you are going to resolve this redundancy? So like you have some redundancy here, you have some redundancy here. Same some redundancy. How you're going to deal with this?
Using HashMap.
Sorry?
Using HashMap type of data structure.
You can use HashMap, right? It depends on, I mean, what type of indexing that you're doing to do.
Sir, we can remove the exact same terms with the same document ID.
Very nice.
There are different document IDs, then we can
very nice
data structures like
very nice. So for example, in this case, killed, right? So there are two killed in the same document. I mean, yeah, you can simply combine them, merge them, right? But if the these, for example, Brutus once in came in document one, in document two. So in that case, basically you can use some kind of listing, right, for Brutus. So how you'll do? This is exactly what you'll do. So multiple term entries in a single document are merged. So for example, Caesar came in one and two. So in fact, it came twice in two. So I mean, that's fine. I mean, you just write two. Again, so that's a frequency. I will come back to that. So just like we were giving example here, killed. So killed is now just converted to one because it is coming in the same document twice. So killed just came in document one. Second thing you do, split into dictionary and posting. And finally, the document frequency information is needed. So when we say the split into dictionary and posting, so what you do, ambitious. So ambitious came in document two. So this is your posting list. If it is coming into more than one document, you simply create, start making a linked list here for the different document. So since ambitious only came in document two, you have mentioned document two, and this is the frequency. So this frequency indicate in how many documents ambitious has came. So if you take the example of Brutus, so Brutus basically came in two documents, one and two. That's why its frequency is two. Can anybody guess why we are keeping track of the frequency here for the different terms you have?
Length of the list, basically.
Length of the list. And how this length of the list will be useful to you? Yeah,
so when doing comparisons, like we can sort by frequency and actually improve the computational performance.
Very nice. So you already answered this before when you have Caesar, right? Caesar probably has just three, I mean, documents stopping at 101, right? So I mean, in this case, I mean, there are three documents having, Caesar. And there is another document having, say, 1,000 entries. Similarly, there is another, token having, which is, another 1 million entries, 1 million document, which is having. So it means when you're going to combine different operations, so you can perform some query optimization. So because probably you may process the list which is smaller first, so that overall operation that you are going to perform will be much less as compared to if you are going to perform the list having highest number of documents. So I will show this with one more example, then probably it will be more clear to you. But at this point, I hope it is clear how we have created the dictionary and the posting for this particular thing. So in this way, let me repeat. So
but here, sir, when we are calculating the frequency, but before that we are merging the tokens that is repeating in one document, then the frequency is not been calculated correctly, because sir, in the first document.
Let me come to the merging, then we can discuss this. Okay, so let me come to merging. So before that, let me just repeat for everyone's reference. So you have two documents, right? So you have document one, document two. So you perform the tokenization and just create the list and the document ID, perform the mapping. So once you have done so, so we need to sort it. And for sorting, you simply perform the sorting here. So once after the sorting, you can see here, I mean, there is a lot of redundancy, and that's how basically help you to make the inverted indexing. So in this way, basically what you have done, simply if the redundancy is in the same document, simply merge it. If redundancy is in other document, then create a list. So in this way, you have created this for ambitious, here the way you have created for Brutus, and so on. In this way, you can do so. So where do we pay in storage? So once one storage is in the storing for the term. What are the other storage you can see? Storing the frequency, right? What are the other storage you can think of? You have the pointer, right? You have the pointer for this term and document. And finally, the last storage will be this posting list. So terms and count, pointers and list of document. So this way, basically, you can also assess how much you are storing, how much storage you required for doing the indexing. So for example, if you have to perform the indexing for whole Wikipedia documents, as compared to you have to perform the indexing of whole, simply the Shakespeare play, which one do you think will take more space, more storage?
Wikipedia,
right? So that's how basically you can make a decision what kind of storage you need to perform, what kind of indexing you need to do, and so on. So when you are implementing an IR system, so there are two major things. So how do we index efficiently? Because again, so indexing can be done many, many ways, right? So you can use arrays, you can use, storing the posting list, you can use list, you can use someone is telling tree. I mean, there are many other things, but how you can come up with efficiently? So that basically you need to think of when you're creating the indexes. How much storage do we need? When we say the storage, there are two kinds of storage. One is the even storing the index is one, and also the whole document that you have. So just keep that these two into mind. So indexing is one of the key thing in any information retrieval based system in order to provide response very quickly. So with this, so now we have created the indexes. So now once we have created the indexes, inverted index, so how we can solve any query? So let's go for the query and then we discuss merging and then we can answer your question. So how do we process query? So just think it that way. So how do you process a query? So for example, you have to solve a query, Brutus and Caesar. So simply you have to look at, because you already have the indexes, right? In your inverted index, simply look at where the Brutus is. So that is the, you can say the key. So once you have the key, so you can get the, you can say the value of that key, that will be the dictionary, that will be the list, posting list. So in this case, this will be the result for Brutus, having 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, and 128 documents. Similarly, you have to find Caesar. Simply look into the index that you have. Caesar, retrieve its posting list. So this is the postings for Caesar. So earlier, what you are doing, earlier you are doing some binary operation, that is the you have performed AND. How you'll do the answer here. So it's kind of, you need to perform AND again. And how you can perform the AND here? So the solution is the merge. So basically you need to merge these postings. That is, you need to find the intersection of these two documents. How you can do so?
Two pointers,
right? So that is one solution. So yeah, so I think, yeah, it's very clear to you. So how we can do, simply walk through the two list, right? Either through pointers or something. And in this way you can find. So what will be the time complexity for this merging? Anyone? Suppose the first Brutus is
M.
X, Caesar is Y. What will be the time complexity?
Order of max of, min of M, no. M comma.
Sir, in worst case, we need to traverse the entire list in both the pointers.
Yeah, so that's what I'm asking. So what will the time complexity?
Sir, order of length of 1 plus length of 2.
Very nice. So the time complexity will be order of x plus y or m plus n, because in the worst case, you need to process all, right? I mean, whole list, similarly whole list. So if the list lengths are x and y, so the merge takes order of x plus y. And how? Basically, you can see this is when you have sorted ID. So I hope you can realize if it won't be sorted, it will be even take more time, right? So in this way, basically the merging, you can make an efficient merge. And you see, how you can make efficient merge if it is sorted. So this is very simple merging algorithm. Simply you have to intersect. So this is postings one, postings two, and you need to finally find this intersection of these two. So simply you have to perform until both lists are empty. If they are matching, then simply add this and increase both pointers. If it is one is smaller than other, then simply increase the other one until they matches. And in this way, you simply run this and you will get the answer. So like in this case, what the answer you will get? You will get 2. And after that, you will get 8. And after that, that's it, right? Yeah, so in this way, you can perform the merging and get the answer for your given query. So now, so someone has asked some question on the merging. And before that, so is merging clear to you? So merging is doing exactly the same operation that we were doing earlier for AND. Is merging clear to you? Any question here?
Sir, can you explain the merging portion again?
Sure.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So there are two parts, right? So in earlier, what you were doing, you have the query. So in that case, you have the, for Brutus, you have term incidence vector, right? Similarly for Caesar, earlier you have term incidence vector. So it's kind of, so if you recall, so for Brutus, for example, the vector was 11011. For Caesar, suppose it was 01001, something like that. If you have to perform a query, Brutus and Caesar, let me probably just go back to the slides. It will be easier for you. Yeah. So suppose earlier you have to solve the query, Brutus and Caesar. So you already have the term incidence metric, right? So you'll see what is the representation of, you can say, the Brutus, because you already sorted this document in the some sorted order. So this order are fixed, right? So always the first one, or you can say the first position will be for display. Second position will be for Julius Caesar. Third position will be for the Tempest and so on. So the Brutus will be represented by, you can say a vector, 110100. Similarly for the Caesar, Caesar is present in the following play. So like this particular play, that's why it's a one. This particular play, that's why it's one. It is not present in Tempest, that's why it's zero and so on. So earlier, if you have to get the solution for Brutus and Caesar, you are simply doing the AND of these two, right? If you perform the AND of these two, you'll get 110100, because since these two are one, these two are zero, it will be zero. So the outcome will be 110100. So it means Brutus and Caesar both came together in these three plays, Antony and Cleopatra, Julius Caesar and the Hamlet, right? So in a way you perform the ending of these two, right? So we have discussed what is the issue with this way of representation, because the matrix will be very sparse. It may be very difficult for you to find the represent if you have very large number of documents, a large number of dictionary, right? So that's why one solution we have discussed, we basically simply need to do, we can consider only ones. So in that case, if we have ones, we can create some indices. So if you have the indices in this way, you can basically represent this. And so how we are representing indices? So now instead of this matrix, what we are having, we have Antony or Brutus, and then create a linked list. So that linked list having all the you can say the place having that. So in this way, this is the representation has changed from this vector to a linked list. So this is the linked list we are referring to, right? So Brutus is present in document 1, 2, 4, and so on. Similarly, Caesar is represented by 1, 2, 4 on. So earlier you were doing AND of these two vectors. So again, if we have to solve the query Brutus and Caesar, we also have to do some kind of AND here. And how this AND will be done? In this case, this AND is done by the merge operation. And this merge operation is nothing but, this merge operation is nothing but, you need to find the common document in those two postings. So what are the common documents here? Common document among these two posting is, because you need to perform AND is nothing but the intersection. So the two is common, document 8 is common, and that's it. So it means given two linked lists, you need to find the common list, common element. And how you can perform that? So this is something called merge. And one simplistic solution could be simply keep looking at the top of this. If they matches, then simply add this to the solution. If they don't match, simply increase the pointer until it is smaller. So like in this case, if you see here, so the first is 2, and in this case, this is smaller. So if some pointer is smaller, just increase it. And you need keep increasing it until either they are equal or they finish the list. So like in this case, this is 1, right? Simply skip it, extend it, 2. So now these two are common. Add these two to your answer. So now both are equal. If both are equal, if you see, you need to increase both pointer. So both pointer now be increased to 4 and 3. Since 3 is smaller, increase this pointer here. So this is 5. Since 4 is smaller, you increase it to 8. So in this way, you keep increasing. And again, the next point they match is 8. Since it's a common document, you add 8 to the results and keep doing this process until the both document end. So once it is in, you will get the answer. I hope I answered your question.
Sir? Yes, sir.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, any other questions?
So to extend like the same method to complemented queries like AND not Calpurnia, like we'd have to first form a list of doc IDs where Calpurnia is not present, right? Like, and then take intersection.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the method, sir?
So okay, so you're saying Brutus Caesar but not Calpurnia, right?
Yes, sir. Brutus and Caesar and not Calpurnia.
So that we'll have to think about, because in case of simple incident matrix, you have simply you converted 1 to 0, right? But in this case, you have a linked list. So I want you to think about it. And since we're running out of time, we can discuss in the next class, by the way. We'll discuss this example in the next class.
Okay.
But I would like all of you to think how this complex query can be solved using inverted index. Brutus Caesar and not Calpurnia. Okay.
Hello.
Yes, Prakriti.
Sir, I have a doubt in that frequency counting thing.
Mm-hmm.
Can you open that slide?
Sure.
Yeah. Sir, the doubt is that if we are merging the document's ID
mm-hmm.
of the same document, mm-hmm. then we are not counting the frequency of token in same document now.
Yeah, we are not counting. The reason being we are not counting because it is already present in that document, right? So anyways, I mean, either it's a present once or twice, you'll be giving that results or you're giving back that document to the user.
But sir, if we are making indexing based on frequency or something like if it is a more frequency.
No, the thing is, this is document frequency, not the term frequency. For term frequency, again, you can create something else as well.
Okay.
So here we are talking about document frequency, not the term frequency.
For term frequency, we can count the terms earlier before the.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I'm not saying that term frequency is not useful. Term frequency will be useful. I mean, in fact, if you have taken class of NLP, there is something called weight of words, right? And how do you compute the weight of words? By TF into IDF. So yeah. IDF is something, the document frequency, this is something you have. You can keep track of term frequency as well in order to find the weight of these words.
Okay.
So what is the role of document frequency here?
In this case, I mean, document frequency will help you in the merging, efficient merging. So for example, let me give an example if I'm not sure if it is here. Okay. Suppose you have a query, Brutus and Caesar, right? And suppose I add another word here, Brutus, Caesar, and California, right? As you know, the time complexity for Brutus and Caesar is X plus Y. Similarly, the time complexity for say California was Z. So what will be the time complexity? First you compute X plus Y, and then whatever is the number, and then X plus Y plus Z, right? So if you have to perform the operation, right? Again, when you come up with the efficient merging, when you have to come up with efficient merging, in that case, if California has a smaller number of, you can say the element in the list, it means you only have to do that much. So rather than doing a bigger operation, if you perform the smaller operation first, in that case, I mean, the overall operation taken by this whole query will be less as compared to we perform the Brutus and Caesar first. So I think I have some example I will show in the next class, because I think I'm running out of time. Yeah, so I can show you one example explaining this topic. So how the document frequency can help you in query optimization. And another example I just given, it can also be helpful in computing the inverse domain frequency, IDF. Okay. Did I answer the question?
Yes, but I didn't get it properly. Maybe next class.
Okay, good. So I believe the next class might have started. So I would like to end here, and thank you so much, everyone. And have a good day.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.